should sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save your name. It's a strong and mighty tower, your name is a shelter like no other, your name. Let the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to
And they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men for God, from every tribe and language and people and nation. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God, in the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Jesus answered, It is written, Man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Once when we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit by which she predicted the future. She earned a great deal of money for her owners by fortune-telling. This girl followed Paul and the rest of us, shouting, These men are servants of the Most High God, who are telling you the way to be saved. She kept this up for many days. Finally, Paul became so troubled that he turned around and said to the spirit, In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her. At that moment, the spirit left her.
A reading today from James 5, verses 13 to 17. If you have a device or a Bible, please turn with me. James 5, 13 to 17. Is any one of you in trouble? He should pray. Is any one of you happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Is any one of you sick? He should call the elders of the church and to have them pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the man well, and the Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he shall be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. The word of the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, that hits home. Thank you for the recipe for wellness that you've tucked away in the book of James. Help us to apply those steps to our lives so that we may enjoy the wellness you have intended and be free of our sickness. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you will help us to take care of the temple, meaning our bodies, for the indwelling Holy Spirit, so that we may run the race with perseverance and do the things that you have called us to do. And we pray this in your precious name. Amen. Well, my friends, we're in a teaching series on healing, pathways to healing. Today's message is entitled, Are Any of You Sick? Well, I can answer that question, yes. By the sheer number of CVS and Walgreens on every major intersection in Atlanta, I can answer that question, yes. And we're living in a time where pharmaceutical companies enjoy profit, they are greedy, and some of the drugs even perpetuate sickness. Well, the good news, my friends, is that Jesus, God, has placed in the Word of God a recipe for wellness, which we just read. It is indeed a recipe for wellness. We do not need to continue in sickness. For those of us who have placed our faith in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, there is a recipe tucked away in James 5. So let's unpack this today. Let me review first from the last 2 weeks that we must get things straight. First things first. You know, the relationship with Jesus is a conversation and it is relationship. That means we do our part and God does his part. We don't just rush into his presence with a wish list without doing the things he's asked us to do. So what has God asked us to do? First things first. If you want to be well, my friends, there are some things that God has asked you to do. And let me just pause and say, if you know someone who is unwell, suffering in sickness, please share this right now. Subscribe and share so that the good news of Jesus Christ will get out. Okay, back to that. What has God asked us to do? Well, it's right here in the book of James. Let's review. First of all, confess your sins. Do this daily. Tell the Lord that you are sorry, that you are a sinner, and confess your sins. Right relationship with God. Confess your sins to one another. Yes, be reconciled. There are some folk who are not safe, and I'm not speaking of that situation, but by and large, most of the time when you have a conflict, there was some small percentage that was yours to own. Confess that and be reconciled with your brother or your sister, your friend. Right relationship with God through confession, right relationship with each other through confession, and forgive others their sins against you. I've heard it said that if you cannot forgive, you are overestimating their sin against you and underestimating your sins against God. Yes, forgive. God commands it. In order to be heard, in order for your prayer to be answered, in order for you to have eternal life, you must forgive those who have sinned against you. Forgive. And ye shall be forgiven is one of the laws that God has knit into this universe. And finally, submit to the Lord's lordship. In other words, he's not just Savior, but also make him Lord of your life. Submit your will to his will. Pray your prayers in line with the will of the Father, as Jesus has modeled in the Lord's Prayer. That's first things first. You must, my friend, do your part to receive an audience from the Lord. He wants relationship. He's not just a bubblegum machine where you put in a quarter and get a piece of bubblegum, or an ATM where you slip in a piece of plastic and out pops a $20 bill. That is not the way God works. God works when you, through relationship, you do your part. God promises to do his part. So call the elders of the church also speaks to the fact that you are in alignment with godly authority. You are active. You are part of a body of Christ. Forsake not the assembly. It is great that you're listening to this, my friends, but I hope it's not on a Sunday morning. I hope you are in church with others who are trying to live the godly life, along with you, holding you accountable, so that when you are sick, you have an umbrella of authority. The elders, meaning those who are overseers, spiritual overseers, are people you will call upon when you are sick, and they will come to your home and pray over you, anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord, and you shall be well. Let me push the pause button right now and share an example from my life. Worshipped in a very large church in the metro Atlanta area, and someone who worshipped with us in a home fellowship on a Friday night decided she would learn to ride a motorcycle, but forgot to ask all the questions and somehow flew headlong over the handlebars and tore her ACL in the process. Was told by the doctors that she would not walk for months and surgery was necessary. Well, I was the leader of the Bible study at the time and involved James 5, verses 13 to 17. Those who were in the Bible study to go to her home on a Sunday after church to pray over her and anoint her with oil in the name of the Lord, just as we read and teach. Well, she was walking by the end of the week. The doctor said no surgery would be necessary. Ran into her at Home Depot the other day. Absolutely no pain. And she was able to work within a week or two after praying for her. Every day significantly better. And this is not something that happens when you tear your ACL. Surgery is necessary, and it does take months to heal, but not when we... She was a faithful follower. Jesus was Lord of her life, and she confessed her sins to one another and to the Lord, and the Lord heard our prayer and her prayer, and the prayer of faith raised the sick. She was literally laying with her foot elevated when we went into her home. And the prayer of faith shall raise the sick, and the Lord will make them well. I can tell you first person, and that is only one example. On the many mission trips to Nicaragua, people were healed. This is for today. It is the same God we serve yesterday, today, and forever. He's not on vacation. God is still in the heavens. The Holy Spirit is still at work. So let me pause and say, I've only heard one sermon. I've been in the church for well over 50 decades. Only one sermon in my entire lifetime that I can remember on the sin of gluttony. Pastors prefer not to preach on that because people can get mad and leave. And then, of course, they take their tithes with them. My friends, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, so is mine. Any abuse, whether it be food or alcohol or drugs or working too much, any addiction against your is a sin against your body. And I don't have to tell you that Americans are some of the fattest people on the face of the earth, and it's not always because of our thyroid. It is because we have poor habits. It is because we are not disciplined. It is because we do not prepare healthy food at home and eat well and take care of the temple of the Holy Spirit. In the Old Testament times, first part of the Bible, the temple was made by hands, brick and mortar. New Testament, since Jesus' ascension, it's your body. For anyone who has placed their faith in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit lives within us, and your body is the temple. So as part of the first things first, the Lord also asks us to take care, love yourself and your body, so that you can love other people, so that the work of Jesus Christ can occur. Do this out of love for God and love for each other, to practice the disciplines of walking with Jesus Christ, which includes taking care of your body. Get enough rest. Reduce your stress. Eat well, my friends. It's common sense. And that is part of the first things. First, see, the Lord can heal you. But if you go back to your old habits, you will become sick again. When the Lord heals you, He desires for wellness ongoing. So watch the habits of your life. Listen to the Holy Spirit and the conviction of the Holy Spirit when you eat too much sugar or eat too much, period, or drink too much. The Holy Spirit will convict you that this is not of God. These habits, my friends, are American habits that we've spread throughout the world, and they are not honoring habits to the Lord, in that they are not kind to the temple. So that's first things first. Now, the Lord also teaches us. Jesus taught it and modeled it. He taught the apostles and they modeled it. And then from there, the elders of the church have now modeled it as well. Under that authority, the authority of Jesus Christ, we function when we pray for healing for ourselves and for others. And what is the authority upon which we base our prayers for healing? There are three. We pray the authority of the blood of Jesus. We pray through the authority of the name of Jesus. And we pray through the authority of the Word of God. We are taught that in Scripture, and let's review these. The blood of Jesus, turn your Bible to Revelation 12, 10 through 11. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down." And they're talking, it's talking about Satan there. "They," meaning the saints, "have overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony." So in Revelation 12, we see that we will, saints, will be victorious in the last day. How? By praying on the word of the Lord, praying the word of the Lord, and through the blood of the Lamb, meaning Jesus Christ shed blood on Calvary. We pray with authority. You have been given the authority to pray just as Jesus did, and how he had taught his apostles to pray for healing for yourself and others based on, as we read, the blood, shed blood of Jesus Christ and the word of God. Let's read more. Hebrews 4:12, that was the basis of last week's teaching. "For the word of the Lord is sharper than a two-edged sword." Let me pause right there. Two-edged, double-edged sword means that God sent us the word. That's one side of the sword, one edge of the sword. He sent us the word. The other side of the sword is that we pray it back. That's what diastomos means. Two mouth, double mouth, God's mouth, our mouth. God gave us the word, we pray it back. Double-edged sword means that it cuts both ways. We base our prayers and we pray the actual words of God on the authority of the word. His very words is a two-edged sword. And it cuts through joint and marrow, soul and spirit, and it accomplishes what God purposed, and it will never return empty. Leviticus 17:11 speaks to the fact that it is only through the shed blood that there is atonement. Old Testament shed blood of the lambs, goats, etc. There wasn't atonement through the lamb. It was just pointing forward to the Lamb, capital L Lamb, Jesus Christ. It is only through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, it says, will there be atonement for our sins. In other words, we go back to the authority of the blood. We're back to the word of God and the authority of the blood. Let's read more. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, before embarking in ministry, spending 40 days in the wilderness fasting, the evil one came and tempted him with bread. And Jesus said, I cannot live on bread alone, but by the very words of God. He was speaking of the fact that, yes, we need physical bread for our nourishment, but it is the word of God upon which we base our lives. And we know from Acts chapter 16, verses 16 to 18, that the apostles carried on Jesus' ministry in the same way. In the name of Jesus Christ, be well. They cast out demons. They healed the sick through the name of Jesus Christ, the blood of Jesus, the word of God. And through the name of Jesus, we are taught to pray. And of course, we just read from James 5 that the elders of the church, even to present day, pray for the sick through the name of the Lord, James 5:14. I've seen Christians use this wrongly. They put the pronoun I in there. There is no I in this. Get the pronoun I out of this. This has nothing to do with you. You are praying only on what Jesus Christ has done through his body on the cross, the blood the name of Jesus, and through the word of God, Jesus being capital W-O-R-D, word Jesus, the embodiment of God. He was a symbol of God. A word is a symbol. He was the symbol of God walking on this earth, the word of God, both written and living. This is where we base our prayer life. Get rid of I speak X over you, or I speak this or that. You have got yourself all over this. This is idolatry. We don't pray that way. We pray only as the Jesus taught us, the apostles taught us, and the elders are to carry on in the name of Jesus, through the name of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus. I pray, or we pray if you're in a group, and we proclaim it is only through him. This is the authority upon which Jesus has gave Peter, the apostle Peter, to establish the church. This is the authority of the word of God through which we are to teach. And it says in the Bible that we can be certain of an answer. Let me talk into this, speak into this. You and I have both known people who were faithful, walking with the Lord, who died in sickness. My father just passed away recently. Walked with the Lord faithfully, loved the Lord Jesus, and he died with sickness. Please recognize that God is outside of time. He is sovereign, and he does heal always. Sometimes it's when the saint sees him face to face. But many times he responds, as he did with my friend who had a motorcycle accident. He responds immediately. Or sometimes he heals incrementally. It's also as the saint becomes in alignment with the discipline of taking care of their bodies, they will begin to cooperate with God, and there's incremental healing. Sometimes it's immediate, sometimes it's incremental, and sometimes it's when we see Jesus face to face. But God always says yes to the righteous. Yes. Yes, and amen. You are healed, you are being healed, and you will be healed, because God is outside of time. So the teaching that you will always be healed like that is falsehood. You see in the Bible that Paul himself had a thorn in the side, and I looked in the Greek and it meant physical. Paul, the greatest apostle of all times, suffered greatly. Suffered in such a huge way, such a faithful follower of Jesus Christ, had a thorn in the side, a physical infirmity. So that teaching is not accurate. However, we are taught to pray with boldness. We went to the home of our friend and we prayed in a circle around her with boldness. We asked God. She was a single parent. She had two children. She worked physically, and she needed the ability to provide for her children. The idea of having savings for months was not there. So we prayed for her with boldness, and Jesus answered yes. So my friends, are any of you sick? Call the elders of the church. Anoint them with oil through the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall raise the sick, and the Lord will make him well.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.